And now, let's compare Honkai Star Rail to real life. I'm just kidding. Welcome to a follow-up video to the graphics of Honkai Star Rail. If you haven't seen the previous one, I suggest you watch it first, because this one is going to cover random odds and ends, like dialogue scenes and character quality, DLSS4 transformer model, mobile lighting quality versus PC, better texture filtering, the secret 120 frames per second mode, the iPad version, and the conclusion. With the release of Star Rail version 3.1, I figured it'd be a good time to investigate some lingering questions I had. But first I want to remark on the level design craft of these new areas. The Murmuring Woods, for example, is a labyrinth twisted around a centerpiece landmark, a great tree in the form of a figure, with vantage points that overlook where you've been, where you will go, and what you could explore, helpfully indicated by conspicuous treasure. It all brings to my mind a certain highly influential game series.
Bringing down the Titans, retrieving the core flames, and filling the vacant seats.
Once the vessel is filled with souls, the gate to Gwyn shall open.
Your souls to the fire!
In any case, I'm having fun puzzling out these new dungeons and enjoying the environment art. It's a pretty good time. Being a JRPG-style game, Honkai Star Rail is chock full of dialogues. I wasn't able to investigate these before, but with a fresh slate of main story quests in front of me thanks to the new update, I can finally make some comparisons. The first revelation is that real-time character shadows in map exploration, which appears when character quality is set to medium or above, actually affects these dialogue scenes, adding screen space self-shadows. No such luck for mobile. Suffice it to say, the characters in Star Rail are unnaturally shaded. That is, I believe the characters are largely shaded by a parameterized tune shader rather than through environmental lighting. On occasion, a nearby light will override the parameterized light vector on the characters, but by and large, their shading does not react much to the world around them. Even indoors, the characters are lit by a phantom directional light coming from an arbitrary direction the vast majority of the time. This room, for example, is especially odd because the character shadows are pointing in one direction, while this table's shadows are going in the opposite way. And even when walking out of the room and into the hallway, the character's shadow remains consistent. What the character quality parameter actually affects is hard to describe. Low quality falls back to a simpler shader for the characters. The artificial rim light on oblique angles is harsher in low quality. High quality seems to add an additional secondary rim light sometimes. Dynamic shadow maps, one of the few ways the characters react to the environment, do not fall naturally in the low quality setting. Instead, being in shade becomes a binary condition. It's either on or off based on where the character is standing. When it comes to medium versus high quality, I can't for the life of me find the difference. I compared numerous cutscenes, player characters in the environments, animated NPCs at multiple distances, and battles. I legitimately do not know what distinguishes medium and high character quality on PC. With the introduction of DLSS 4, NVIDIA introduced a new slate of DLSS temporal reconstruction models using a transformer-based machine learning architecture, which differs from the previous convolutional neural network-based models. I won't pretend to understand it, but we can look at the results by swapping the DLSS model to the latest in the NVIDIA driver, which as of writing is version K. Taking it to the jukebox of Shimmery Death, we once again observe that DLAA produces a significantly less flickery result than the game's native TAA. Even in its lowest setting, which is upscaling a 720p base render to 4K, the results are respectable considering what it's working with. The mild ghosting I observed in the previous video examining DLSS 3 still remains in DLSS 4, though it's rare that I notice it in live gameplay. hardcore head-to-head shootout between DLSS 3 and 4, I tried a character with a busy emote. But then I noticed the cherubs flanking the central character lack any anti-aliasing whatsoever, which is pretty strange. It even affects the DLSS modes. So scratch that, let's try another character with a high motion animation. Once again, the game's native TAA proves not to be very good at anti-aliasing, though it doesn't produce any ghosting artifacts. I would like to believe that's a conscious trade-off that miHoYo made, but in the face of NVIDIA's infinite R&D resources, old-school TAA doesn't stand a chance. Comparing it to their last-generation model, the new DLAA produces a mildly sharper result with less artifacting. Dropping the settings down, we can observe image breakup on this fast-moving character. High-contrast anime graphics have a tendency to bring out the flaws, though when things are perfectly still, the image is very nice. Ultra Performance Mode is a worst-case scenario that I'm including for curiosity's sake. Even NVIDIA themselves only recommend it for 8K displays. On the player character, Ultra Performance at 4K produces a smeary mess. Though DLSS can produce good results at conservative settings, it seems to break the game's capsule shadows as of writing. Hopefully miHoYo will fix this issue because the upscaling modes are quite useful in scenarios where you need the extra performance, like the 120 frames per second mode. To avoid this issue for now, use DLAA or TAA. Speaking of 4K, one sentiment I've heard about DLSS is that it's only useful at high resolutions. NVIDIA trains their models with a 16K reference render, so the purpose of DLSS, Deep Learning Supersampling, is to approximate supersampled imagery. To put that to the test, I decided to make my own supersampled reference by cranking the rendering quality to 2x at 4K. This means my GPU is rendering Honkai Star Rail at 8K with TAA, and I captured and downscaled the result to 1080p to produce a supersampled ground truth. 16 rendered real pixels going into every 1080p pixel. I cut my poor old RTX 3090 some slack by halving the frame rate. How do all the modes compare to ground truth? TAA, as expected, is pretty crunchy. DLAA tries hard and produces a less speckled image than TAA, but when things are set into motion, the ground truth is supreme. Though when viewed at full speed, it's hard to see the flaws. In practice, DLAA is quite good. When looking at these comparisons, it's important to think about the render scale. DLSS quality mode is effectively upscaling 720p to 1080p. Balanced mode is working with a 628p output, which is in line with PC games from the late 90s. I didn't dare test anything lower than that. When it comes to low-motion anti-aliasing, the native TAA absolutely crawls. DLAA at 1080p is reliable enough. The 8K ground truth benefits from sharper textures, but we'll take care of that later in the video. For ghosting, DLAA at 1080p only produces noticeable artifacts in these edge cases. The lower the base resolution, the worse it gets. So maybe there's some truth to the sentiment that DLSS works best at high resolutions. If you're gaming at 1080p, stick with DLAA or quality mode, and if you got the horsepower to spare, a little extra render quality helps. One loose end I've been meaning to look at is the light quality of mobile. How do the settings map to PC? Well, mobile's very high is at least a match for PC's high, though I did notice the omission of these clouds. Mobile's high is most similar to PC's medium, but with some cold lights in the background. Mobile's medium is a match for PC's low. Mobile's low is a match for PC's very low. And let's call mobile's very low an exclusive. On mobile, Very High gives you ambient occlusion, as I noted in my previous video. But for this one, I wanted to gather some more examples. And what I found is that Very High gives you dramatically improved lighting setups in many areas of the game. So yeah, my recommendation for keeping light quality on Very High stands. It's the most impactful graphics option you can reach for. One significant omission in the graphics options is texture filtering quality. For discrete GPUs, it's usually safe to crank that to the max, but since the option is not available in-game, we can force anisotropic 16x in the driver. At the least, it provides a little extra clarity to textures at oblique angles like floor patterns. In some scenes though, it upgrades the textures for scenery in the mid and far field. May as well turn it on, and if miHoYo is watching, please put it into the graphics menu. I feel dumb for not checking the PC Gaming Wiki listing for Honkai Star Rail, because there's a 120 frames per second mode that can be enabled with a registry edit. Special thanks to the two people who left comments on my last video. On one hand, this is the best thing ever. It has a huge degree of motion clarity to the game, and once you see it, it's hard to go back. Unfortunately, I have no way of conveying this effect on YouTube, which only supports up to 60 frames per second video, but I can at least prove that it works by playing my 120fps capture at half speed. If you got the hardware and the display, definitely try it for yourself. On the other hand, this mode is hidden for a reason. Some animations have glitches, such as these errant frames that happen around camera cuts, though this is hard to notice in real time. The worst I've noticed is the juddering and shaking of this particular ultimate attack. Even though the mode works, the game was evidently never QA'd by miHoYo at 120 frames per second, so it follows that this isn't an officially supported feature, but in the vast majority of gameplay that I've seen, it looks pretty good. And for those who use the fast-forward toggle in combat, which I imagine is virtually everybody, this makes the rapid action more pleasant to look at. A friend of mine was gracious enough to send me a few screenshots of the iPad version, from which I can immediately tell that the iOS and Android versions share the same numerous missing objects on these storefronts. Once again, please watch my previous video detailing these differences. The screenshots also show the difference that Metal Effects makes, which is to say, not much at all. Metal Effects has two flavors, a simple spatial upscaler and a full-blown temporal reconstruction technique. This is similar to the difference between DLSS 1 and 2 or AMD's Fidelity Effects Super Resolution or FSR 1 and 2. I think what we're getting here on mobile is the FSR 1 equivalent, a not very effective image upscaler. Unfortunately, none of my friends have a PlayStation 5 right now, so no comparisons for that. But now that you've seen my videos, you should at least know what to look for to gauge its approximate feature set. Because this is a scattershot follow-up, I have no grand conclusion to make this time. I would like to see the graphics bugs fixed, anisotropic filtering brought to the menu, and 120fps mode made an officially supported feature, but otherwise I think that Honkai Star Rail is a graphically complete game. Zenless Zone Zero recently received some ray tracing effects. Based on a comparison video, it looks like reflections and some very low-key global illumination to my eyes. Though it's not anything transformative, it would be nice to see those features brought to Star Rail as well. And that's gonna do it. I hope you enjoyed this esoteric analysis. As always, I stream game development on Twitch, so you can catch me there.
Ashen One. Hearest thou my voice still?